I would like to thank you for coming this afternoon to honor the memory of Kenneth Acker as well as to celebrate his life. I have to take care of an announcement. There will be a luncheon at the KC Hall immediately following the service here this afternoon. I'd like to open with a passage of scripture that most of us, I'm sure, have heard many, many, many times. And it's the 23rd Psalm. But today, as you listen, the psalmist has personalized this psalm in many different ways. I, myself, me. Would you be willing to try and insert your name where it is personalized? Can you truly say, the Lord is your shepherd? It says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's pray. Father, we come before you today knowing that there will be a day where we as individuals face those last days on earth. And the question is, how will we face them? Will we face them with fear, worry, wondering what's going to take place? Or will we look at them with the anticipation of the promises given to us in your word? A promise that you've gone to prepare a place for us. And because of that, we don't have to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope, as Paul writes. We can have the assurance of that promised home in heaven. So today, let that be a comfort to us, knowing that your love is unfailing. That is it is unconditional, and we can rest in that promise. So bless this time we spend together, in Christ's name, amen. We're going to listen to the song, How Great Thou Art.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder.
sings my soul, my Savior God to thee.
How great thou art, how great thou
art. I'm going to ask Susan to come and share at this time.
Good afternoon. I'm Sue Backer, Kenny's sister-in-law for the last 35 years. I have so many memories of time spent with Kenny. I want to share a few of them with you today, and I'm sure there's plenty of great stories that you could be told in memory of Kenny today. Kenny dreamed of growing up and working for the wildlife or forest service, but as you all know, that wasn't God's plan for him. Instead, his life work was farming with his brother Dale since they were 18 and 15 years old after their dad passed. Kenny's two favorite jobs on the farm were spraying and harvesting. Weeds would drive him crazy. He was always scouting the fields, and even in his later years, decided to get technology and purchased and operated a drone to help with those scouting missions to eradicate every last weed. There's always work to be done on the farm. I remember Kenny coming over, and Justin was just a little guy, and he innocently asked Kenny if he wanted to go play kickball. So that became our standing joke on those seldom days when we didn't have a whole list of chores planned. Someone would mention a game of kickball. While farming was his life's work, his passions were still wildlife and conservation. He loved hunting, trapping, fishing, writing, and planting more trees. He would come over and tell us how many more replacement trees he had to plant because of the deer or a chemical residual. And that, my friends, is a whole different story. He would ask for some help hooking up the postal digger on the tree point because he wasn't going to hand dig them in. He loved his trees, and I think he helped his own children and most of his nieces and nephews, including mine, identify leaves for their school projects. I can't remember how many times I asked him about a bird or a weed I didn't know, and he would look it up and let me know what it was. He would spend hours sitting in his chair by his patio door and just watch the wildlife in his yard. He knew how much I loved fishing, so he'd invite me along. We always had a good time on the water, enjoying conversation, a few beers, and somehow never seeming to catch many, but that didn't matter. Whenever Justin went fishing with Kenny, he'd come home with a big smile and a funny story to share. Kenny had a quiet humor and wit that amazed us all, as his eyes would light up and twinkle. Always after the elusive hot spot, he even purchased a rubber raft, thinking he could fish some of the smaller sloughs, only to discover unloading and reloading it was more than he could handle alone. So over he came to supervise the fabrication of a winch Justin had, Kenny mostly supervising, to solve that problem. When he did catch some big ones, he'd stop in so I could take his picture so he could share it with his chums at the local watering hole, a favorite place where he loved to socialize and razz everyone. I loved to listen to his stories, coyote hunting. He even shot one and let me have a tan to hang in my house. He'd get excited to tell me about the new call he purchased and play it for me and how the coyote responded. Again, if he got a nice one, it was picture time to share with his friends. Kenny always loved to write stories. One time he let me read his short stories of his youth. Wow. Could he write? And I couldn't believe it came from him. He didn't talk anything like the way he wrote. So with some encouragement, he started writing a book to add to those short stories. I spent a lot of time with him getting the story just right into the computer. And of course, whenever there was a computer glitch, we had to call Justin to fix it. He loved being able to call Justin to help him fix his electronics, repair a flat tire, work on his boat, or climb under his pickup for repairs. He was so excited and proud to finally get his book published, and he shared it with many. Kenny was a creature of habit, doing most of the same things day in and day out. He served on the Nicosic Township Board for many years. He loved watching his kitties out his patio door and dropping leftovers for them to enjoy. One day he mentioned he was going through a lot of kitty food. Come to find out, the coons loved his generosity too. He took care of that problem. He had pet names for everyone. Our dog Coda, he always called Elfie, and take her to rides to check the fields. When he would share a story from the watering hole, we would have to ask him their real name so we knew who he was talking about. He loved lots of things, but most of all, he loved his big boys. He was always razzed about by everyone because he was a small one when he stood with his boys. He enjoyed fixing them a holiday duck and never failed to mention how many taters he had to peel to feed those big boys. He was very proud of his sons and the men they have become. So Since we lived so close and we were together so much, over the years, I think I became his personal assistant. If he had a medical concern, or he would have me check his vitals or his blood sugar, make his appointments, pick up or return purchases, make business calls, citing he couldn't hear, when he really hated being put on hold, and he hated paperwork. Some days he just wanted to talk, but I got the bigger payoff. I got to hear all those quiet, witty jokes and stories that he heard when he'd stop by and share, and his quiet chuckle using his shoulders. You know what I mean? Kenny always kept a light on 24/7 at his house, and after he passed that Monday morning, I drove by and looked for his light, and it was on. However, when I left that day, the light was out, and that's when it became real for me. We're really going to miss that guy, and I'm sure all of you are, and he wasn't just my brother-in-law. He was our family. Fly high, Kenny. Keep the light on. I'll be looking for him.
We're going to listen to another song, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
in Psalm 90, the psalmist writes about the brevity of life. You know, I see some of you that have the same color hair I do. And it's just amazing that, didn't it fly by? I mean, it's just amazing that, I didn't think I'd make it to 30, let alone double that. But the brevity of life is just beyond our understanding. And the psalmist writes about that. In Psalm 90, he writes, the length of our days is 70 years or 80 if we have the strength. Yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. So we deal with all sorts of trials and tribulations in life. And I guess, how do we handle them? Are we downtrodden because of it? Or do we find hope knowing that there is another day to come? Well, I don't know if you've ever heard of King Solomon. I'm sure most of you have. A wealthy man. If you were to compare him to maybe somebody today, it would be a Bill Gates or somebody like that. They had so much money, didn't know what to do with. Well, because of his wealth, he was able to experience anything that he wanted to. And he writes about that in the book of Ecclesiastes, where he tried everything under the sun, meaning everything on earth. And he came to a conclusion at the end of this book, chapter 12, verses 13 and 14, is the conclusion, and this is what he says. Now, all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or evil. Well, if you're anything like me, that makes a guy kind of think, man, what about all those things that I've done? Am I truly worthy enough to enter into God's kingdom? Well, I want to tell you something. It doesn't depend upon what I do, whether or not I get into God's kingdom. Now, that might kind of throw some of you off kilter a little. But God's word tells us, if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So it's by faith that you're saved. By your belief. By confessing with your mouth. Now, I know there's going to be people that say, well, you got to be baptized, or you got to speak in tongues, or you got to give so much to the church. You've got to do those things to be saved. Well, that's not what the Bible tells us. Those are man-made ideas and rules. God's word tells us that it is faith in Christ that saves us. Now, does that change the way you live? Yeah, probably. It did me. When I accepted Christ, I changed my lifestyle drastically. Does that give me more contentment in life? Absolutely. Because I know my salvation does not depend upon what I do. It depends upon what Christ did on the cross. And because of that, I have the promise found in God's word, that he's gone to prepare a place for me. And if he's gone to prepare a place for me, he will come back and take me to be with him. So today, do you have that hope? Well, there is another promise that, oh, many don't know, but it's found in the book of Thessalonians. And it's Paul writing to the church at Thessalonica. And he's telling them that, well, there were some in Thessalonica that were wondering, well, what happens to those people that die that have trusted in Christ before he returns? Well, this is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through the end of the chapter. And it says, "Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him," meaning have died in him. "According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive and are left till the coming of the Lord will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever." So there is a promise of a resurrection. Christ being the first fruits, the first one to be resurrected. Those who trust in him will be resurrected as well. Now, I don't know about you, but there's times in the morning where I get up and I can't wait to have a different body than the one I have now. And that's what's promised, that we will be like Christ. Paul also writes in the book of Corinthians, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You see, our soul and spirit depart from this earthly tent, and through faith, we are promised that we will be with the Lord. So I guess today, you know, if I were to ask you, do you really want to be attending a funeral? You'd probably say no. But because of your love for the family, for Kenneth, the friendship that you have, you're here to honor him. And so when you're here, it brings out our own mortality. So when you think of that final day on earth, how will you face it? With hope? With maybe even anticipation of what awaits? Because of the promises in God's word. Today, put your faith in Christ and you don't fear death because of what awaits you. Let's pray. Father, we know that it's difficult. It's difficult for us to understand that we really need someone besides ourselves to enter into your kingdom. The only way that we can do it on our own is to be absolutely perfect, and that is impossible, we know. So we have to rest in the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the one that paid the price by that shed blood, so that through faith in that, we can be justified to enter your kingdom. So I pray you'd help us to understand the importance of that, and that we would rest in it. So I pray that you would bless and comfort the family in the days, the weeks, the months ahead. Reaching to make that phone call and realizing that Ken's gone. There's going to be many times where that pit in the stomach comes about, and yet, Lord, you're there if we look to you to give us the strength to deal with that and face that. So I pray that you would comfort them and give them that peace. Your word says that through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, if we make our requests known to you, you will give us that peace that passes all human understanding. So bless them in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. We're going to listen to one more song, Go Rest High on the Mount.
Oh,
has gone home, the call remains for those of us that are left. Please stand with me and receive the benediction. To him who is able to keep us from falling, to that one and only